everyone who has hosted me, in fact. Can you hear me, everybody? Nominally democratic nation states seem to be moving towards the kind of polities normally associated with authoritarianism. And this transformation may be especially visible in relation to fake news. Doctored images, rumors, conspiracy theories, and the divisive testimony of eyewitnesses, staples of autocratic conditions, adumbrate what is fast becoming a generalized global atmospherics of doubt. Now, in the war-torn dictatorship of Syria, these dynamics appear in bold relief. We see the media's demand for sensational content driving regime supporters and well-meaning citizen journalists alike to massage, if not fabricate, evidence, including video footage, leading both Syrian citizens and global observers to doubt the validity of news reports and the claims of fact-finding missions. These conditions have tended to enable the frayed Syrian state's counterinsurgency campaign, which works not so much by maintaining credibility in itself as by casting doubt on all reporting, thereby seizing advantage in an oversaturated, high-speed information environment. So the argument I'm going to make today is threefold. First, and this is a lesson Syrian citizen activists learned at tremendous cost, too much information may actually generate the very uncertainty that putting it into circulation is intended to allay. Over the course of the uprising, the Syrian state's ideological apparatus, no longer able to brand the regime as a kinder, gentler version of autocracy, learned how to exploit conditions of fear and insecurity to counter human rights activists and citizen journalists' attempts to document the truth. By disseminating its own claims and counterclaims, and by taking advantage of an inexperienced, conflict-ridden opposition, the regime has not always been able to establish its own authority over the facts, but it has been successful in raising doubts about the nature of evidence and the credibility of oppositional narratives. Second, information overload and the potential for uncertainty it generates, as scholars of American politics have long pointed out, may induce people to seek out opinions reaffirming their own, and this is something I've been talking to a number of colleagues about here as well. This tendency towards balkanization can lead to polarization. Internet users, to take an oft-used example, tend to gravitate towards sites that function like echo chambers, where people relish the sound of the stories they're telling themselves anyway, and the stories they tell themselves about the stories they tell themselves. This gravitation toward a comfort zone in which believing is seeing or hearing may have little to do with actual facts, even on the assumption that the latter are ultimately knowable. The atmosphere of uncertainty cultivated by an excess of information can create what I call siloed publics, where debates take place within narrow communities of argument that allow interlocutors to take pleasure in encountering views that confirm their own. Third, the very condition of uncertainty provides some with an alibi to avoid committing to judgment at all. And I think this is the most novel argument I'm going to make today. In conditions of information oversaturation, and perhaps especially when feelings of present danger extrude a surplus remainder of threat potential, to borrow Brian Massumi's formulation, uncertainty can provide a potent seeming rationale for inaction in a context where action might otherwise have seemed morally incumbent. In the current context of massively intensified violence, reasons for hunkering down and staying safe overwhelm. But in the first years of the uprising, this recourse to non-judgment mattered. A self-satisfied ambivalence was nurtured by an atmosphere of doubt that justified political paralysis and withdrawal. particularly among the professional managerial elite, including cultural producers. Their silence helped the regime navigate the changing circumstances of its rule. So in contrast to stereotypes of autocratic rule, in which it's the withholding of information that enables domination, the Syrian case lays bare a set of mechanisms by which an excess of information can be exploited for political gain. But the Syrian example does more than that. It invites renewed exploration of the general, consistently fragile relation between truth and politics, while exposing the specific ways in which the specter of imminent danger works when dangers have, in fact, become immediate. So by way of getting at these dimensions of uncertainty in conditions of what I call high-speed eventfulness, I want to unpack two exemplary moments. The first is the controversy surrounding the mystery of who might have murdered a well-known singer and left his mutilated body on a riverbank as a warning to activists, if indeed he was killed at all. The story marks an important turn in the uprising when it became apparent that activist expressions of cross-country solidarity, outrage, and creativity could lead to overreach, in other words, to exaggeration, a rush to judgment, a conflation of a clear political position with murky facts. The second event is the seemingly incommensurable example of the chemical weapons attack in eastern Al-Ghouta in August of 2013, a devastating event, the evidence of which has pointed in different directions, animated a global community of politicians, activists, and scientists, and in terms of ultimate accountability, served to polarize those with already firm positions, even while regenerating uncertainty for others less sure of their commitments. Bringing these two examples together allows us to see in events local and world historical the production and reproduction of an epistemic and affective insecurity whose speculative practices conduce to favor the beleaguered Assad regime's counterinsurgency project, or at least its survival. Now, throughout, the talk is informed by the thinking of Hannah Arendt and Ludwig Wittgenstein, and in the closing pages, I put Syrian artists whose current work unsettles the conventions of documentary representation into conversation with these two theorists, drawing out mutual points of relevance for our understanding of politics in the local Syrian as well as more global, including Indian, present. So in the early days of the uprising, an anti-Assad song emerged that became a political phenomenon in its own right, recorded on cell phones, uploaded on YouTube with simple rhyming lyrics and a catchy rhythm, enjoining Syria's president to step down and leave the country. The song had a catchy chorus, "Go on, leave, O Bashar, Yalla irhal ya Bashar," which came at the beginning and end of stanzas, invoking familiar conditions of first family corruption. The song also responded to current and changing events, reproduced slogans from various parts of the country, conjured up historical references of regime betrayal, and offered rejoinders to the president's own speeches. Exhilarating in its irreverence, with crude insults leveled directly at Bashar, his notoriously brutal brother, and his female cousin, the song was at once angry and joyful, challenging the self-evidence of tyranny while paying homage to lives lost. Performing a newfound sense of solidarity, the lyrics invited popular participation, which came in the form of extemporaneous add-ons, expanding and adapting the song, giving license to each singer, author, and listener to act in concert in the acoustics of revolutionary change. Avoiding the abstractions of earlier, more elitist political songs, the added stanzas not only perpetuated defiance, but worked to air publicly what had hitherto been predominantly private grievances. The proliferating stanzas also beckon diverse areas of the country to furnish new details, alerting others to specific injustices and making them common knowledge. The repeated recourse to the straightforward imperative, go on, lead, and to the proper nouns of failed leadership, moreover, summoned into being cross-class identifications, a soundscape of national solidarity, untethered to the regime's official discourses, giving voice, literally, to the protesting crowd's potentiality. Now, at first it was widely thought that the singer of the song had been one Ibrahim Fashoush, who worked at a fire station in Hama and supposedly occasionally performed with another local, Abdul Rahman Fahoud, or as he was more popularly known, Rahman. And I should say Hama is the fourth largest city in Syria. This is a picture of, with the largest uprising, actually crowds in uprising terms, proportionally anyway. On July 4, 2011, Fashoush reportedly turned up dead. His corpse left on the riverbank with its larynx carved out. Now, many understandably interpreted the murder as an act of crude symbolism, presumed at the time to be the work of regime thugs bent on punishing the subversive singer in the most graphic way possible. In these assumptions, people were probably wrong. First of all, the singer of the song was likely Rahmani, not Fashoush. And Fashoush, far from being a subversive singer, may have been a police informant. Many offered homage to the departed, if wrongly honored, Fashoush, yet in likely being mistaken about who Fashoush was and the role he played in the events in question, many on Facebook posts and creative songs and videos made after his death ended up paying tribute to a possible informant whose body it may or may not have been that was found missing its larynx by the side of the river. Moreover, when Fashoush turned out to be suspected of traitorous complicity, whether responsibility for the mutilated corpse lay with regime thugs became doubtful, at least to some. Stories then quickly emerged about vigilante activists having executed Fashoush or someone else for collaboration. Finally, as it scripted, sightings of Fashoush surfaced in 2013, accompanied by articles and Facebook photos attesting to his continued well-being in exile, culminating in a GQ article, Gentleman's Quarterly article, of 2016. This piece, reported a few days later in Arabic, so first in English, then in Arabic, claimed to break the story that the real singer was not Fashoush but Rahmani. The latter was alive and well in Spain, but Fashoush had, in fact, died by the Orontes River, a guard, not a fireman at the station, who did not sing revolutionary songs, or for that matter, any songs at all. The article discusses the circulation of rumors, sins of omission by both Rahmani and opposition outlets, an effort to report the truth by the late Anthony Shadid of the New York Times, and importantly, the failure of that story to stick in an avalanche of new media propaganda. The Fashoush story thus becomes exemplary of a conflict in which truth claims, rather than accumulating a collection of established facts, recall something more like a shifting kaleidoscope of possible alternatives, registering both the uprising's complexities and the multiple efforts to people over them. The regime not only helped produce these conditions of uncertainty by barring professional journalists from entering the country, but also repeatedly capitalized on them, seizing on moments of exaggeration and misrepresentation to discredit opposition positions, polarize communities of argument, and disorient worlds in which truth claims might lead to action. The regime's advantage lay not in its exercise of strict control over, say, an ideological state apparatus, but in not having to be believable in order to be powerful. From the inception of the uprising, the burden of obligation was always on activists who had the moral high ground in calling for an end to tyranny, dignity, and a civil state. Citizen journalists had the onus of being the symbolic corrective to autocratic dissembling. Now, the philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein teaches us, quote, that the truth of certain empirical propositions belongs to our frames of reference. Continuing, quote, when we first begin to believe anything, what we believe is not a single proposition. It's a whole system of propositions. It's not a single axiom that strikes me as obvious. It's a system in which consequences and premises give one another mutual support, unquote. What we're seeing in Syria, and arguably elsewhere, too, is the collapse of these frames of reference, and with it the annihilation of truth in Wittgenstein's sense. Not the truth of philosophical a priori principles, but the political truth of empirical propositions, by which I mean what counts for purposes of politics and political discourse as matters of fact. Wittgenstein's insistence that what allows our beliefs to make sense is the relational system in which they are embedded points to the difficulty involved in judging evidence or ascertaining the nature of truth claims circulating in Syria's so-called media wars since the uprising began in March 2011. In this respect, the story of Fashush is more than an isolated incident of mistaken identity. The mystery about who might have murdered the well-known singer, or indeed whether he was killed at all, his contradictory deployment as a symbol of oppositional courage and regime brutality, and then later of regime co-optation and the opposition's revenge, all this is but a single example contributing to an entire economy of uncertainty, which works to dilute moral outrage among addressees who otherwise might be available for political activation, and cause standards of political judgment to come unmoored from the very conceptual systems in which they're situated. In this context, the curious lack of follow-up articles and interest by opposition activists so invested in the song and in the purported singer's purported murder could be read ungenerously as indicating a cover-up of journalistic failings. Or it could be seen as symptomatic of reading and writing habits cultivated in conditions of high-speed eventfulness and information overload. But this silence, relative to the commotion caused by the initial discovery of a corpse by the river, also speaks to a collective disappointment born out of the uprising's ongoingness, the forms of depredation that have squelched revolutionary exhilaration and made people tired. The song had originally beckoned ordinary people to take part in something momentous, to participate in events charged with the embrace of political responsibility, to sing what they mean. The revolutionary idea of Fashush had already been assassinated, as one activist put it, taken down not only in conditions of uncertainty, but I want to argue, in part, by them. The second example is the chemical weapons attack. On the night of August 21st, 2013, videos began to circulate online of civilians gasping, convulsing, and foaming at the mouth in the eastern Damascus suburb of Al-Ghouta, showing every sign of having been poisoned. Doctors Without Borders confirmed 3 days later that staff had observed at least 355 deaths from neurotoxic symptoms at three medical centers in the neighborhood. Regime forces agreed to a ceasefire in the Ghouta area on August 25th to allow UN inspectors to conduct on-site investigations, which took place during a series of five-hour ceasefire periods from August 26th to 29th. It was during this time that Secretary of State John Kerry issued a statement appearing to commit the U.S. to some form of direct military intervention against the regime, which in Kerry's narrative was known to have been the perpetrator of the atrocity. Well before the UN investigation was concluded, he described his certainty about the regime's responsibility as, quote, grounded in facts but informed by conscience and guided by common sense, unquote. He also alluded to secret information that would settle the matter once and for all, and which he promised would be revealed in due time. Four different kinds of warrants, the factual, the moral, the census communis, and the classified, converged to produce what Kerry claimed was undeniable evidence. But as time wore on, Kerry's failure to produce decisive proof generated the very conditions of deniability that his assertions of incontrovertibility sought to discount. Now, despite Kerry's initial insistence on certainty, or perhaps in some instances because of it, what was supposedly already clear to the world in his terms, namely that the Syrian regime was behind the attack, became increasingly difficult to discern amid the inundation of claims and counterclaims prompted by the Secretary of State's statement. And the more information that emerged, the more uncertainty it seemed to generate, both in and outside of Syria. And I should say that this project is the product of 24 years of fieldwork in Syria back and forth, but I was there when the uprising took place, so I had connections both in and outside of Syria. Some reports basically confirmed Kerry's allegations, using eyewitness accounts, relying on the circulation of information and images on social media sites, and producing a plethora of articles translated from Arabic to English and vice versa. But as early as a week later, a counter-narrative began to emerge, one that placed ultimate accountability with the opposition. Although these early dissenting reports appeared to lack the authority or credibility, they nevertheless became increasingly susceptible to uptake, less a way of anchoring an alternative certainty than questioning the empirical propositions on which existing frames of reference relied. In chat rooms and online publications, rumors began circulating about the Saudi intelligence chief having supplied the weapons to a Saudi militant, allegations that instantly generated their own confusions, including whether a named author in one prominent report had been involved in writing the piece at all. The story of the attack took a technical turn with the publication by the New York Times of an article that drew upon a study by Richard M. Lloyd, an expert in warhead design, and Theodore A. Postol, a professor of physics at MIT. The study promised a scientific resolution of the accountability question by addressing a previously unnoted problem at the heart of the investigation. How could what were initially thought to be rockets with minimal carrying capacity deliver enough gas to kill so many people over such a large area? Lloyd and Postol subsequently published a second report casting doubt on UN and US calculations of rocket trajectories, further generating skepticism about the Syrian regime's responsibility for the attack. Memorable among the participants in what became a high-stakes bout of discursive jostling, with Western intervention and presumably regime survival hanging in the balance, was Syrian presidential spokesperson Hussein Shaaban. In a statement given as early as September, Shaaban held the opposition responsible for the attack, and I quote, "They kidnapped children and men from the villages of Ladiya," she reported, "and they brought them here, put them in one place, and used chemical weapons against them. That's the story that the villagers in these villages know," unquote. In this narrative, the victims were by implication members of the Alawi sect from areas supportive of the regime and not supporters of the opposition. Despite the outrageousness of this account, Shaaban thereby accounted for what would seem to be the central problem the regime had in telling its version of the story, namely why opposition forces would victimize civilians loyal to them. Especially interesting, however, is how Shaaban, who had just offered as definitive evidence for her claim that the villagers in these villages know, concluded, "But why don't you leave it to the UN Commission to investigate, to analyze?" Or again, quote, "Western countries are always very scientific. They go by the law. They investigate. Why, when it comes to something concerning our countries, they say it is believed that the Syrian government used chemical weapons? Why don't you wait for the specific scientific results of a neutral UN committee that is investigating?" Unquote. The incoherence of her appeals and the sheer outlandishness of the story nevertheless produced its own rejoinders, including reports noting that the regime's kidnapping scenario would require a five-hour trip by a large caravan of buses passing unhindered and unnoticed through numerous checkpoints. In other words, the story could be simultaneously dismissed and addressed. Efforts which themselves registered anxieties about the work uncertainty can do in turning ethical, political judgments into confusion, with implications for global actors as well. One more aspect of Chauvin's preposterous statement is worthy of note, namely her appeal to science. And here, too, science worked less to establish truth or falsify fallacious claims than to convert what might have been consensual knowledge into political opinion, including the view that we can never know what happened. The scientific democratization of expression, personified by opposition-identified and very impressive amateur analysts who argued that only the regime could have launched such an attack, could not override the views of experts like Lloyd and Postol, but nor could these MIT-authorized scientists do more than produce speculations in a world saturated by claims already at work, re-instantiating communities of agreement in place. These were not conspiracy theories of the caliber that Chauvin and others brought to the fore, but their very existence as disagreements made it possible for those whose minds had been made up in advance of circulating evidence, which was itself confusing, to stay that way. U.S. President Barack Obama's primetime speech on September 10th and President Vladimir Putin's New York Times op-ed the following day looked like a throwback to a Cold War politics in which political posturing trumped all curiosity. Facts already hard to adjudicate became pared down to an acknowledgement that something bad had happened, a chemical attack, while attributions of responsibility broke down on classical political fault lines, with Obama assuring the American people that the regime was behind the attack and Putin recommending caution by placing blame on the opposition. The UN's own authority as a fact-finding team and its careful language regarding what it could and could not ascertain was undercut by its own past mistakes. Its reputation as a partial international body rather than an objective arbiter of truth claims produced doubts about its conclusions as tenuous and as carefully worded as they were. The appearance of an investigative report by the well-known journalist Seymour Hersh in the London Review of Books entitled "Husserin" raised additional doubts. In counteracting American administration claims, Hersh contended that Obama failed to acknowledge something known to the U.S. intelligence community, that the Syrian army is not the only party in the country's civil war with access to sarin, the nerve agent that a UN study concluded without assessing responsibility had been used in the rocket attack. That's a quote from Hersh. Faulting various studies circulating online and through conventional news channels, Hersh maintained that it was known that Jabhat al-Nusra, the Al-Qaeda affiliate in Syria, also had access to the necessary ingredients to make sarin and had demonstrated interest in using it. In a follow-up piece published in April 2014, Hersh went further, suggesting that Turkey was in fact behind the Ghouta attacks. These claims then showed up, so note the circulation, in Arabic language media, becoming the majority of what a reader still got in 2017 if she Googled in Arabic who is responsible for the Ghouta chemical weapons attack, both with an IP address in Chicago and an IP address in Beirut. This still popular question, and so many others like it, who was responsible for the chemical weapons attack in Arabic, is made to order for conspiracy theories. Now, conspiracy theorists view what might be regarded as disparate happenings as connected, products of an overwhelming logic or intentional force whose interests are ultimately served by and organized through another's victimization or ruin. And they're not always wrong. Hersh's investigation was potent because it was plausible. Structuring arguments in terms of what some scholars have termed pejoratively a paranoid functionalism that posits effects as the product of purpose, the question who is responsible for the chemical weapons attack could be harnessed to a familiar regime narrative of national vulnerability and threat, in which the national became, once again, coterminous with regime-oriented. Now, questions of who is behind a specific act need not reduce to a conspiratorial narrative, of course. For others, the very positing of such a question conveyed a sense of collaborative unknowability. in which doubt could modulate affective registers like outrage and disgust, along with the political judgments that might ensue. Phrasing like the following was typical. The regime and opposition groups could plausibly deny responsibility, at least for those who were open to skepticism. It was not simply that camps were polarized with staunch loyalists and people in the ambivalent gray area following regime-oriented sites and tracking investigative reports such as Hershey's, while official opposition sources called for U.S. intervention because the regime clearly had crossed Obama's red line. For as young people identified with the uprising became increasingly disillusioned by both regime and opposition, as the impossibility of adjudicating truth claims came to apply to increasingly continuous acts of unspeakable cruelty, some, in exile, sought to redefine and radicalize the terms of debate, conceding to a situation in which facts were especially vulnerable and everyone might lie. And so the final part of my talk, shorter part, from impasse to bypass, making openings. The loss in Syria of what Arendt calls a common world is dramatized by the relentless soul-crushing violence, but also by an atmosphere of doubt, whose logic has dictated a familiar recourse to forms of certainty that polarize some populations around what they think they already know, while also providing others with grounds for disengagement and disavowal, in that they know that they do not know. These situations complicate profoundly the possibilities for political judgment. We see in Syria today the constellation of mutually related rules, propositions, experience, techniques of reasoning, everyday practices, and mental images through which we are trained to judge, in Wittgenstein's sense, having been undermined by a world in which information is paradoxically both incomplete and overwhelming, a situation in different form which arguably also characterized the recent United States election and ongoing scandals associated with the Trump regime. And I'd be very interested to hear about parallels and also contrasts with what's going on in the Indian situation. As Hannah Arendt acknowledges in her rich essay, Truth and Politics, quote, "The politically most relevant truths are factual," unquote. And they are, as political theorist Linda Zirilli underscores, also the most in peril, the most vulnerable to human mendacity and to the pursuit of narrow political interests. Politics is a domain of plural contingent opinions, argues Arendt, where the understanding of freedom is rooted in an appreciation of the human capacity for speech and other kinds of action. Wittgenstein shows us how such a world is made up of reference frames that are subject to collapse. Some Syrian filmmakers share this appreciation, showing us the death of politics that occurs when a common world in formation has been crushed by dissimulation and violence. So I want to show you one clip of the anonymous film collective, Abu Madara, whose work over the course of the uprising suggests that when journalistic conventions are challenged, something creative and out of the ordinary might happen in their stead. For the most part, the collective's short films hint at prospects that are left vaguely defined, gesturing towards experience of self-assertion as well as of self-dissolution and unpredictability. They offer accounts of events or situations in which there may be room for reclaiming judgment as a political activity. So this clip that I'm going to show you is number 3 of a 4-part series that chronicles the evolution of a soldier fighting for the opposition, his decomposition in the face of wartime's gruesome intensities, and his attempts in part 4 to recalibrate his relation to the world. So part 1 establishes the soldier's first realization that he could kill. He was scared, but he felt he had no choice. That refrain, that he had no choice, provides the central animating theme of the first segment, a testimony to judgment suspension, or at least compromise, to the simultaneous recognition and evasion of responsibility, to an emotional catastrophe that leaves the social fabric torn. He had to protect his family. He knows it's wrong to kill, but he had no choice. He fears God, but he had no choice. The regime left him with no choice. Part two describes his experience of entering a home and finding children who had been lying dead for some days. There's no obvious cause of death. The soldiers were looking for food and water and just happened into the dwelling. Describing his search through the house, he bears witness to a mother's love for the son she holds against her, both dead. He tells us that the buildings behind the house where he and others have been fighting were besieged by the Assad regime's army, and he cries as he recalls the terrifying experience, part of a relentless nightmare in Syria's central city of Homs, the third largest city. It is a war that is both disorienting and suffocating. The remaining inhabitants of that embattled area were, quote, as afraid of us as they were of the Syrian army, he admits, wiping tears from his eyes and noting, quote, how truly frightening it was. Residents could not open a window for fear of being shot. There was literally and figuratively, quote, no breathing allowed, unquote. And these two segments lead us to part three, in which the soldier has become self-consciously or dissociated or split. The word intisam means both in Arabic. There's no psychoanalytic distinction. So dissociated or split from himself. Here the soldier recounts killing someone by cutting the person's throat. In the soldier's retrospective lamentation, he notes that while his body slaughtered the victim, his soul was crying. Now he can scarcely imagine having done it. No level of resentment or revenge can make that, quote, legitimately.
العالم شفتهم والمجتمع بالجيش الحر كانوا كنت اتعامل معهم ما بريد اني انتمي لهم ما بريد اني انتمي لهم انه في غلط كثير بس هو اني من حقهم بس كحق يعني انه حق بس ما هو مشروع بنظري حرام ما بعرف ممكن يعني الأغلاط موجودة بس ذبح ليش؟ ما عرفت وأنا ليش ذبحت؟ ما بعرف شو سبب إني ذبحت مثلا السكين؟ ما بعرف شو مسكت السكين وذبحت بالزلمة ما بعرف ذبحته وطلعت بكيت والله ذبحته يعني جسدي ذبحه ما روحي انه شيء صار يعني انه انفصام يعني انه كل شيء لحال جسدي لحال وروحي لحال جسدي ذبحه طلعت لبرا روحي صارت تبكي قد ما زعلت على رفقاتي اللي ماتوا يعني ما لازم اعمل هيك قد ما كان حقي مداس علي يعني ما من حقي اني اذبح حد يذبح
Theirs was initially an ethical war, a war against tyranny, but in experiencing it, their hopes have been mangled. They've become other to themselves, having been forced to make choices their real selves would never have made. The promising possibilities of a common world put forward in early days of the uprising have by now been crushed by violence and all of its accompanying distortions. The broken soldier may also be reclaiming the human capacity for politics by turning to speech and repudiating violence. In a situation reminiscent of Isaac Dinesen's memorable observation repeated by Hannah Arendt, Mujib Rahman reminded me of today, quote, all sorrows can be born if you can put them into a story or tell a story about them, unquote. And this quartet seems to be the soldier's attempt at restoration, at making himself whole once again in a context in which, quote, consequences and premises have ceased to give one another mutual support, unquote, as Wittgenstein writes. In such a context, what is to be done? Abul Nagara offers no answers, but the films bypass the impasse posed by fake news and subsidiary forms of insecurity, sidestepping the evidentiary logic of news stories and conventional documentary genres by occasioning new possibilities for reflection in a context in which the usual grounds for judgment have been undermined. In distinction to official opposition and regime proponents alike, with their polarizing answers always at the ready, the collective embraces the ambiguity of the situation, extending even to questions of what the national community might look like, given what the war has done to what could conceivably be called Syria. In doing so, Abul Nagara gives up on a certain kind of knowing without giving up on judgment and political intervention as such. Whereas both the regime and the multiple oppositions demand that people take sides for or against, Abul Nagara's commitment to complexity is not the same as the frame-breaking uncertainty that provides an alibi for non-judgment. On the contrary, the recognition of the fragility of subject positions allows viewers to embrace a temporal lag between perception and action without giving up on the latter. In other words, to be humble and befuddled without being abject, an invitation to revitalize judgment with the full, albeit paradoxical, knowledge that nothing is ever fully known. So to conclude, what I've called the temporality of high-speed eventfulness, or the sheer velocity with which information is transmitted and apprehended in the internet age, occasions the forms of discursive oversaturation this presentation has described. The unceasing whirl of overinformation makes it easy for people to move on to something new the instant a favored narrative fails. These new conditions pose conundrums for judgment, showing how in the Syrian regime's case, media manipulation is a shorthand here for both direct propaganda efforts and an ability to take advantage of matters put into circulation by others. Interfered with activists' capacity to maintain or develop a revolutionary narrative. This means that stories are either easily knit into the narrative fabric of stories people are already telling themselves, or that political exuberance is flattened, in the latter case ending up like Abul Nagara's unknown soldier, mired in doubt and disillusion. An atmosphere of doubt is part of what Slavoj Žižek, the philosopher, calls systemic violence, which in the Syrian case operates in cahoots with other forms of overt regime brutality to extinguish or dampen what began as incendiary political excitement. In this context, artistic efforts such as Abul Nagara's are like embers, a trace of light and heat, a past-bearing invitation to begin anew.